Morning.
Good to be here again this morning. Now, I've got the privilege of having somebody help me this morning, so don't get bored with my voice. Amelia has gladly agreed to read some of the verses, so I'm going to step to the right and invite Amelia to come up and just use this microphone here. Thank you so much. John 18.
To Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "You also are not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked him, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others ask you to say it about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, and I might not be delivered, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" And Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come to the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I should release one man to you at the end of Passover. So do you want me to release you, the king of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." And Barabbas was a robber.
Thanks very much, both two of you, and Joe, for having me up. Beautiful passage, isn't it? And as we spend some time thinking about it, let's just ask for God's help to do that this morning. Father, we thank you for allowing us to have such wonderful insights into some of the most precious moments around the past hours in your son's life. They're very rich with meaning and teaching, and yet there's so much there that we appreciate, as we have this morning, thinking about the sacrifice that he made to allow us to come into fellowship with you. So we ask this morning that by your Holy Spirit, you would open up these verses to us. Give us the help that we need, and bring glory to your name in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Yeah. There was as you can see by the length of the reading, that it's a very full chapter, and so much there to have a look at. And what I really want to do is touch on a couple of things. My overall theme, I guess, is pictures of Christ, because there are so many glimpses of his person within the text that we've read. So we want to lift some of those out and enjoy those. But as we start into the passage, I want to look at the way that the Lord Jesus is in perfect control. And so there are some things that we need to understand about John's Gospel. I mean, the last time that we looked at it, we were in chapter 15 together, and we can see some of the important changes that are happening, that John makes distinction, between one section and another. So at the end of chapter 12, we saw him withdraw from that public ministry, and it was a private setting. And so from chapter 13 right through to 17, it's private with the disciples. And then in chapter 18, we have another change. This now becomes his passion ministry. The ministry of his passion. It takes us right the way through to the end of John's Gospel. So there is another sequence of events that are unfolding here. It's wonderful to see that the Lord Jesus is revealing the character of God as we enter these verses. As you journey from chapter 14 through, you'll have seen the way that the Lord Jesus has displayed glimpses of the tabernacle and all of that rich treasure chest holds for us. We can see there in chapter 14 that he starts to unfold new doctrine, new teaching. And it's like you're entering into the tabernacle. On the right, there's the showbread, the bread of life, being broken up for the disciples. That goes through into chapter 15. And then in chapter 16, he starts to talk about the Holy Spirit. And it's like the light goes on, because at the end of chapter 16, the disciples say to him, "Oh, now you're speaking clearly. understand. It's like the light's gone off for them. But in chapter 17 is the golden altar of incense, isn't it? And those prayers that the Lord Jesus prayed ascend up to heaven itself. Just a beautiful glimpse into that fellowship between the Father and the Son. Praying for his own and those that would love him, which include us, in a coming day. Some beautiful moments are captured there. But here in chapter 18, and our brother was enjoying how he brought in Joshua this morning, it really connects so beautifully with what we have here. It's the Ark of the Covenant. And it's going down to Jordan. We can see the person of Christ going out before his people. He's facing. He alone will display the power of God. The ark is wood overlaid with gold. Deity in human form. But as it goes out, it will cross the waters and into enemy territory. The ark speaks of the love of God. The Lord Jesus exemplified that as he steps out to restore relationship that he didn't make. Looking at this map, I pointed it out because it's interesting that the last events go from Bethany to Bethphage, the Mount of Olives. And from there, we know that Jesus went to the garden. Over here is the temple. That's where the Jews were plotting to kill him. Just outside to the north would be Calvary. Here he is in the garden, and he's moving towards the enemy. No fear. Undaunted. Facing into the challenge. He is going to restore what he didn't take away. Doesn't it touch your soul? Doesn't it lift your heart to think that he was prepared to do that for you and for me? It's wonderful, isn't it? He goes into the garden. As he does so, I'm reminded of another garden. Genesis 3 comes to mind. The Lord Jesus is in a garden. In that first garden, we read that God liked to go in the cool of the day and talk with Adam. Until Adam decided to disobey God, and to do his own thing. And in doing so, he plunged the entire human race into sin and death. And here we find one in a garden. And what's he doing? He's about to go out and restore that broken link from God to man by the offering of himself. And so, we find that he sets out, Herodias knows the place he's going. He's taking with him a group of soldiers, and they're coming out with lanterns and torches, and they're armed. They're ready to do battle. Now, Peter is there. He's at the forefront. As we read those verses together, I'll move there for you now. As we read those verses together, we can see how enthusiastic Peter is to stand beside his Lord and his Saviour. It's not made clear to us why Jesus allowed him to take the sword, even though he knew he would do something silly, like try and lash out and cut someone's ear off. But it does, again, give evidence to all of those soldiers that came to take him by force who it was they were dealing with. Here was no ordinary man. As he turns and tells Peter to put away his sword, he reaches out and touches the ear of the servant. It doesn't say that he bent down to pick up the ear that was cut off. He could have. It doesn't say that. All it says is that he reached out and he touched it and his ear was new. Evidence of the Creator. The one that formed the first garden is in the second garden. The first Adam brought us into sin. The second Adam restored all things. It's lovely, isn't it? The pictures, the glimpses that we're getting. But here it is. We're brought into the situation where Peter is going to deny his Lord, and we must look at that for a number of reasons. John tells us that there are three occasions that Peter denies the Lord Jesus. He says and explains that, first of all, Jesus is taken to Annas, who is the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest, that year. After that, he records the first episode of denial. And then he says that Jesus is taken to Caiaphas, and he is scrutinized once more. And then after that, two more occasions, Peter denies the Lord Jesus. Now, what is interesting is, we often think that Peter just denies him three times. But it's clear from reading all the Gospels that it's more than that. For example, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all agree that on the first time that Peter denied the Lord, it was a servant girl that was asking him the question. So that's agreed. Everyone's on the same page. The second time, Matthew and Mark record it like this. Matthew says, it was another woman. Mark says it was the same woman. So there's at least two people involved in that situation. On the third occasion that Peter denied the Lord, Matthew and Mark both say it was a group that was standing around. Those that stood by were asking the question. Luke definitely says it was a man. And John says it was the relative of Malchus whose ear was cut off. So we can see that there are at least five or six times that Peter denied that he knew his Lord, but on three separate occasions. And you could understand that. People are pressing around him, pushing him, quizzing him, asking if he was one of them. And he's denying left, right, and center. Then the rooster crows. No, I don't want to be hard on people. That's not my intention this morning. I do wonder if Peter had stayed away and prayed as the Lord Jesus asked him to, things might have gone different. I don't know. But I don't want to be hard on Peter. The Lord Jesus said to him, Peter, you'll deny me. He said, no, I'll be with you, Lord. I'll be there. I'm not afraid to die with you. I'm going to defend you, Lord. And that's why he took the sword and he was all involved. And we know he's passionate about it. careful. But thank God, the Lord Jesus said, I have prayed for you. He secured him before the events unfolded. But let's consider this. When the Lord Jesus said, if it's me that you're looking for, let the others go, they all left. They're all gone. By the time we get to the situation around the fire, it mentions only Peter and another disciple, which we assume is John, by the way. But Peter seems isolated in this attack and accusation. Where are the others? See, for all of Peter's faults, love drew him back. When the others disappeared into the dead of the night, Peter's love for his Savior drew him back to his side. May we all have some amount of courage like that man to stand beside him. I need to move on. There's so much still to get rid of me. As the events unfold, we're given the different trials that take place. So there's three religious trials and there's three civil trials. Firstly, it's Annas that's involved in the religious trial. Then secondly, we have Caiaphas, the chief priest, the elders and the scribes. And then later, the whole Sanhedrin, it mentions, are involved in a trial. Three times over, a religious scrutiny. Then equally, there are three civil trials. Firstly, we begin with Pilate. Then Pilate sends him to Herod, and then Herod sends him back to Pilate. The night is full. But what I want to do now is just to lift up some of those things that portray the Lord Jesus. When he's in the garden, and they come and ask for him, it says Jesus went out to meet them. Jesus is the title that he received at birth, meaning Jehovah saves. So at the outset of his interaction with those armed soldiers, we have his title, Jesus, the Savior. They try to limit it and say, Jesus of Nazareth. All they're really doing is saying the scriptures is correct. He came from Nazareth, humanly speaking. So they are confirming scripture. But this next one is astounding. When he asked them, who are you looking for? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am. I am. Did you notice what happened? Every single one of them took a step back and prostrated themselves on the ground. Isn't that astounding? Now, why did that happen? Exodus 3, Moses said, who will I say has sent me? And God said, I am has sent me. What Jesus is doing is saying, I am God. And at the sound of his words, they had no ability to resist that power, but went backwards and fell on their face. Now, we know that they stepped backwards. How do you think they went forward? Or how am I getting that, you say? The same word is used many times in the New Testament, but when it's associated with the person of Jesus, it often links it with the word worship, and it symbolizes the bowing of people in front of him. Look it up. It's really intriguing. And here we have the enemy coming out with swords and staves, and they are compelled to bow on their face, and they still don't get it. Even after that, they pick themselves up the dust. And he asks them again, who are you looking for? And they say it again, they're not learning anything. They've seen the witness of his creatorial power in the air being restored. They've seen themselves just compelled to worship this person on their faces before him, and they still don't change their course of action. Incredible, isn't it? The next thing that happens in verse 14, we get this remarkable statement about a substitute. Caiaphas had made reference to this, that one would die for the people. Now, before we think too highly of Caiaphas, he really wasn't interested in this whole idea of substitution. He was really interested only in protecting his own position and keeping face with the Romans, who were the rulers of the land in that day. So it was better for him if one person was put to death than that everybody had to suffer. Did you notice that he said that in John 11? In John chapter 11, Caiaphas made that statement, which means that from then onwards, they were intent on putting Jesus to death. They had murder in their hearts. But in so saying those words, he has verified the purpose and plan of God that one man should take the place of many. Isn't that remarkable? God will use his words, however self-seeking they were, to confirm his purpose. And then it speaks of a high priest. Now, even in that setting, things weren't as they should have been, because it says about the high priest's father-in-law being involved. It talks about Caiaphas that year. Things weren't being done as God intended. However, they missed the fact that the high priest was there in the middle of them all. And yet they're trying to question him. And Hebrews tells us, doesn't it, that here is a high priest who didn't need to offer for himself. He was without sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21, he did no sin. Peter tells us that in him is no sin. John tells us he knew no sin. There was nothing of sin in this one. He didn't have to offer for himself as the Old Testament priest had to, and then for the people. He could only go in to offer for us because he had no sin. The high priest to end all high priesthood. He had no beginning and no ending like Melchizedek. They missed it all. They missed it all. It's incredible, isn't it? Interesting that they were asking him questions, and then he turns the situation around. Can you picture that? They're saying, you know, what is your teaching? What are your disciples believing? And he said to them, I have spent my entire teaching time in front of you all, in public. You know what I said. And if you want witnesses, which is what they should have done according to Jewish custom, then go and get them. Get the blind man back in John 9. Get the woman at the well from John chapter 4. Get all those people that heard me and responded. They'll tell you what I said and what I did. It's out in the open. They weren't interested in that. They were just looking to trap him. But he turns that situation around and he says, because they responded just by hitting him. And he says to them, if I have spoken to God, give evidence. If not, why are you striking me? He is unfazed by these circumstances. He's unfazed by them. He's in complete control. He knows that they don't have any evidence against him. He knows that they're acting outside their authority and outside of the purposes and direction of God. And they've got nothing left, so what do? that's happening here. They wouldn't go in to Pilate's judicial hall. And what is the reason? Because we might be defiled and can't eat the Passover. The Passover was standing in front of them. Exodus 12, wasn't it? He was there. Mind you, it's interesting that we've seen already that the Lord Jesus had that time with his disciples and he broke the bread, then he instituted the Lord's Supper. He experienced that with them. He shared that meal. He celebrated it, and now he goes out as the true Passover. They were so busy in their scheming and judgment in trying to trap the Lord Jesus and then put him to death, they hadn't had time to do what they should have been doing, which was celebrating the Passover. And no wonder that they missed that the answer to it was there, whose blood would be shed and would be a covering, not now for a household, not now for a nation, but for the whole world. His blood would be on that mercy seat and cover it and set us free from judgment that would have been ours. Isn't it incredible? Now, very quickly, he comes in and has to deal with Pilate. Now, Pilate's troubled by this. We know in another gospel, his wife has already warned him, silly man, he didn't listen. Don't have anything to do with this just man. But here he is, he's caught in the middle. He's got to deal with the situation. The Jews won't come in, but they're paying for blood. If he doesn't keep things in order, then he'll be in danger of losing his life from Rome. So he asks Jesus, he says, are you okay? Now, interesting the response that comes back, isn't it? If Jesus had said, yes, I'm the king, Pilate could have had just cause to say, well, he's in opposition to Rome, we can put him to death. If Jesus said no, then he would deny himself and his rightful position. So what does he say? What's in your heart, Pilate? What's in your heart? Have you worked this out yourself, or are you just listening to other people? What's going on, Pilate? Pilate doesn't like this approach, and he retaliates and he says, am I a Jew? Should I know these things? You see, it's interesting, isn't it? There's two really important conversations that take place in John's Gospel, one of them in chapter 4, and the Lord Jesus is speaking to a woman that's searching for Christ. And he talks to her about worship. John 18. Here he is with a representative of the world power at that time. And he's talking about the king and his kingdom. You see, Pilate can't avoid the situation. Because the next statement Jesus makes really throws it in his face. Far from being fearful of Pilate, the Roman emperor, the emperor's representative in Israel, he looks him in the eye and three times over says, my kingdom, my kingdom, my kingdom. If my kingdom were of this world, it's not of this world. Is in the world, but not of it. Pilate, you've got no power over me. You've got no control over the situation. You think you're heading up the power, the most powerful nation in history in Rome. You've actually got nothing you can do here. My kingdom. So he asked him again, are you a Jew? He said, you have said it. I was born, and for this cause came I into the world. He's identifying first his humanity. He was born. Then he says, I came. He's indicating deity. He was sent into this world for this purpose, to bear witness of the truth. Pilate says to him, what is truth? I don't think he was really interested in it. Because the next thing he does is disappear out to the crowd again and sign the death. What is truth, says Pilate? Truth is a person. And that person was standing in front of him. John chapter 1, 14, verse 14. Behold the Lamb of God, full of grace and truth, both in equal measure. The Lord Jesus could say himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Have we found truth today? Have we faced truth and accepted that the only truth that's worth having is the person of the Lord Jesus? Have we accepted that we're sinful and we're not fit for heaven, but that he is the way to the Father, and that asking him into our lives, we receive the salvation of God through the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ? What is truth, said Pilate? Here is truth. The person of the Lord Jesus. As we go out into this week, let's have the courage that Peter had to try and stand by him, for the wisdom to know our limitations. Let's have the desire to learn more about the truth and to share that with those that are seeking. This is an important time of year where people are open to conversations around what's happening for us at Easter. Tell them about the way, the truth, and the life. The one who came from heaven, who met death and the enemy at Calvary, and he destroyed them all. And now he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. And we can come into the good of his salvation by believing in his name. Father, we thank you again for the Lord Jesus. We thank you for all that he means to us. So rich and full of meaning in these verses. Help us to think on them through the week and to enjoy them and to appreciate all that it meant for you to send your Son to Calvary and for him to face death and the enemy and deliver all those with all their lifetime subject to bondage through fear of death by the shedding of his blood. Thank you for Calvary. Thank you for our Savior. Equip us to go out and to serve you and to share your truth with us.